What up, Hyperchange? Welcome to another episode. This segment is called The Good News, where I recap headlines, articles from the Hyperchange disruptive tech universe that happened during this week. And I wanted to call it The Good News because I feel like mainstream media, CNN, any news cable network that you watch is always telling you the bad news, tragedies, things like that. So I'm gonna keep it real here with good news about tech, Hyperchange. First thing, Lyft raised $1 billion at an $11 billion valuation led by Alphabet, the parent company of Google. This is fascinating for a couple different reasons. First included in the report is a clue that Lyft wants to IPO as soon as next year. So I'd be on the lookout for that. That's gonna be one of the most exciting IPOs of 2018 if it does go down. Additionally, remember Google invested in Uber way back when it was like a $3 billion valuation. Now they're also investing in Lyft. And at the same time, they're building out their own mobility service with Waymo. So really fascinating to see Google put their chips on a lot of different players in this autonomous race, even though they have their own internal service. Stitch Fix, the company that will send a box of clothes to you, you can try them on, pick only what you want, and then send back the ones that you don't want, filed for an IPO. They did over $250 million in revenue last quarter, putting them at over $1 billion revenue run rate. The companies have been operating at about break even with a minor loss recently. This IPO comes at a fascinating time. As we've covered on Hyperchange, Amazon unveiled something called Prime Wardrobe, which is almost an exact replica of Stitch Fix just a couple months ago. It's still in beta. We haven't seen that hit mass scale. Is Stitch Fix pulling a Blue Apron here, trying to IPO before Amazon screws their whole business? Maybe. Additionally, I'm really not convinced in the moat that Stitch Fix has, if any. For instance, Under Armour just launched something called Armor Box, which is the exact replica of Stitch Fix. They send you a bunch of clothes, you pick what you want, you send what you don't want back. You know, Stitch Fix was a first mover here. They had a great little business model, but now it's becoming very apparent that anybody can just replicate this with their own brand, and it's not that hard. So I'll be really curious to see how Stitch Fix does after the IPO and we continue to see their financials. Amazon just opened its largest wind farm. This is 1 million megawatt hours a year of energy that it will produce. Each turbine from the windmill is more than 300 feet tall and has a wingspan of 2 Boeing 787s. The scope and the size of this wind farm is just unbelievable. Amazon has a bunch more wind farms in the works. They're pushing heavily into renewable energy. The bulk of this is going powering their AWS data centers, which require a massive amount of energy to store all of your data. And there's a really funny video that Jeff Bezos posted on his own Twitter where he's like on top of this windmill, smashing a bottle of champagne, looking super yoked. So I don't know, I just thought that was hilarious. Snapchat just launched its next hardware product, and it's not what you think. It is a dancing hot dog costume. Yes, they're selling this on Amazon. It's sold by Snap Inc., the company, and it is a dancing hot dog costume. Remember, the dancing hot dog was the augmented reality star that was put in over 1 billion snaps when they launched it. Talked about it on the last conference call. All the Wall Street analysts were making fun of it. Well, now the dancing hot dog's coming into the real world with the costume for Halloween. Everybody on Twitter was kind of clowning on Snap for this. I think it's a really smart idea. Snapchat's pulse on culture is so much far ahead of every other social media company. This is a meme. This is a phenomena. I think this costume is going to be a huge hit and only cement Snap as the forefront of this kind of millennial digital culture, which is really important. So even though this isn't moving the needle revenue-wise, I actually think from a brand standpoint, this is genius. But in other not so good Snapchat news, Snapchat has actually been hit with layoffs. They're laying people off and letting people go, which is fascinating because they have over $3 billion in cash in the bank they just raised from their IPO. So they have plenty of money, but they're choosing to downsize. Is that because their ad sales are slowing? Maybe. Other analysts have been talking about that, so we'll see when the quarterly numbers hit. Additionally, Evan Spiegel in an email to employees last month said that they would be slowing hiring significantly next year. So we'll see what's up with Snap, but it sounds like maybe they just had too many people working for them already. MongoDB, the database management company, IPO'd this week. They're now trading at a valuation of $1.6 billion, which sounds like a lot given they only did $100 million in revenue in the year ending January 2017. But this was a company that was valued at $1.6 billion 2 years ago in their last fundraising round. So in the last 2 years, the valuation stayed flat despite the business growing. I think this is just a symptom of the era we were in a couple years ago where these database companies were getting absurd valuations in the private market. And you know, we've seen them since come down dramatically when they hit the public market. Hortonworks, Cloudera, these companies have gotten hammered when they go public because people can see their financials. They're making no money. It appears there's no real economies of scale. I don't know when any of these companies are going to start to be profitable. MongoDB is in the exact same boat. They're losing a ton of money each quarter, almost negative 100% operating margins. I'm really a skeptic of the company and the business, but I will also say they appear to have a really good product. Adobe, eBay, Citigroup are just a couple of the people that use MongoDB services. Blue Apron, the biggest meal kit debacle we've seen in a while, is just announcing they're firing over 300 people, about 6% of their workforce, heading into earnings. This is a pivotal quarter coming up for Blue Apron. Everybody's going to be watching it to see if they can keep up their growth, to see if they can rein in their spending. On the edge of my seat, I think it's going to be a disastrous quarter for the company, but I'm going to be watching the financials. I'll cover them here on HyperChange, but for now, it looks like they're firing people going into that report. Probably not a good sign. The deadline for submitting a bid for Amazon's second headquarters city was this week. A bunch of companies are submitting bids. It's all over Twitter. I think Amazon's headquarters too. I don't know what city it's going to be in, but I think it's going to be in a red state. If you'll think about Seattle, it's super liberal, super democratic state. The biggest risk to Amazon as they get bigger is them being broken up and, you know, some government official campaigning on the fact that there's antitrust issues with Amazon because they're so big and they're so disruptive. The best way to delay that scenario is to get bipartisan support by establishing a base in a red state where you are hiring a ton of people and the economy is reliant on you. If the economy is reliant on Amazon, it's a lot harder to mount a fight against them. And that's why I think it's a no-brainer for them to establish HQ2 city in a red state. In the HyperChange universe, put out a few episodes this week. The most recent one was all about Amazon's patents for new ways to get packages to you faster. They patented drone beehives, blimp warehouses, underground tunnel networks, and this is all to combat the fact that their shipping costs are rising faster than revenue and they need to innovate around this. It looks like they're going to launch some sort of crazy drone delivery in the next couple years. Additionally, we launched a new educational series called Investing 101, which is designed to help new people who don't know about investing to learn about the stock market. We're going to keep putting out episodes every Wednesday, so be on the lookout for those educational videos. Also, Netflix reported earnings this week. They ended the quarter with over 104 million subscribers, posted almost $3 billion in revenue. The company is a growth machine, so did an in-depth review of their earnings, their financials this week, so make sure to check that out if you're a Netflix fan. Also, did an episode on the news about Tesla firing hundreds of employees, which was taken way out of context by the mainstream media. Nobody did any homework to analyze that these were actually just due to performance reviews, run-of-the-mill firings, no news there. So made a quick video about that. You can check it out. Also, this week's Moonshot Monday, if you missed it, we pitched that Warren Buffett should buy a stake in the Walt Disney Company. Disney is getting ready to launch two over-the-top streaming services in the next 2 years, ESPN and Disney Plus Pixar. They're pivoting their business model into something exactly like Netflix. This is a huge transition. It was the biggest thing happening in media in the next couple years, in my opinion. The stock is getting hammered because of this. Meanwhile, the company is super profitable. They're buying back stock. This is exactly the kind of business Warren Buffett loves. In fact, he's bought Disney a couple times in the past, and so I think it makes a ton of sense for him to buy it, because through this transition, they're going to be buying back stock, reducing the share count. And once they're through this tricky period in a couple years, I think the company's going to be growing and bigger and better than ever. Think about it. There's more screens in the world than ever before. Disney previously is having to use third-party distribution to get their content to you. Now they can go straight to you with the power of the internet. And I think that's going to make their addressable market a lot bigger than it ever has been in the past. So that wraps up the first edition of the good news. Let me know what you guys think in the comments. If you have any articles I should include for next week, please let me know. That's HyperChange. See you guys next time. Peace.